Welcome to the Building Faith Families podcast with Steve Demme. I'm your host, Scott Moore. Thanks for joining us today. Hey, Steve, I'm sorry this is take two. So for our listeners who don't know that, we recorded a funny little thing and then I hit pause because I'm just used to hitting pause and I didn't get it going again. Anyway, how are you, sir?
Well, I'm good. And just remember, there's no condemnation to those that are in Christ Jesus. Romans 8:1.
Thank the
Lord.
Don't
beat yourself up, brother. It's okay.
All right.
Okay. So I was given a little bit of a rundown, if you're interested, to the listeners, because most of you have either heard me speak at a conference or you use Matthew C. Or, but this last weekend, I had the privilege of being in Ancaster, which is, I come from Lancaster with an L, L-A-N-C-A-S-T-E-R. And it was fun because I got to speak in Ancaster, Hamilton, Ontario, A-N-C-A-S-T-E-R. And I thought it was going to be a really nice trip, nice in the sense that it wouldn't be all day travel on Thursday and all day travel on Sunday going home and then there on Friday and Saturday. This was one of the few conferences where I was going to fly up Thursday night and fly back Saturday night because it's 400 miles from home and there's a direct flight from Harrisburg, which is only 30 minutes from my house. So Thursday, I did a bunch of stuff in the morning and around the house, and I thought, I'm going to get everything lined up here because I have an easy flight. So I drove to the airport a little bit early because it was an international flight. And I got there at 2 o'clock and I walked in and there was nobody at the Air Canada booth. And there's a sign up on the wall, flight canceled to Toronto at 4 o'clock. I said, nah, you can't be just canceling flights. Nobody called me. Nobody reached out to me. I didn't get an email or anything. And so I called Expedia where I'd purchased the ticket and they confirmed that it was indeed canceled. And I, after spending a half an hour with them on the phone looking for options, maybe there was a later flight, maybe there was a flight from a nearby airport, nothing showed up. So I took a deep breath and I thought, you know, it's only 400 miles. Maybe I'll just drive 395. I think I found out this morning on my computer. So I called the conference coordinators up there and I said, I'm going to be in, but it's going to be late. And I just took off and filled up the tank, stopped at a Walmart, got a bunch of food to eat in the car so I wouldn't have to stop and eat. And, you know, I'm on this special diet, so it's limited what I can eat and I can't go through drive-thrus. Then right before I was entering into Buffalo, it was raining, it was dark, and some friends from that area who I was going to reach out to when I was up there, their missionary friends, they reached out to me and they said, "Hey, what's going on? And any way we can help?" And I explained what was going on. So they recommended a hotel that they've stayed in several times right across the border. It's a good exchange rate. So I thought, okay. I said, but you know, I don't want to stop and have to look up all this stuff on my GPS. Can you just text me the information? So they did. So I got in. I think it was about 9 o'clock or 9:30, something like that, on Thursday night. And I spent the night in the hotel and I got up early in the morning to beat rush hour. And I made it to the conference by about 8 o'clock. I was supposed to have my first keynote at 9:30, but I was tired and I wasn't on my A game. And my first two workshops, I felt like I could have done better. And so I took a power nap in the afternoon. And then my 4 o'clock workshop, I just felt a lot more physically and emotionally present. And got a good night's rest. I was in bed by 9-something that night. And I slept about 9 hours and got up Saturday, was refreshed, spoke 3 times. And I kind of wanted to get off early because I wanted to get home Saturday night because Sandy had been gone for 2 weeks helping her, one of her closest friends and the maid of honor in our wedding, who's passing from this life to next. And so Sandy, she was weary and I wanted to get home so I could spell her and she could rest and Johnny and I could go to church on Sunday and let Sandy sleep in and stuff. So I was wanting to get a little start off, but you know, I really didn't want to leave because these people in Ontario were amazing. I stood at my booth for the next 2 hours until they closed the exhibit hall after my last workshop. And we had heart to heart, meaningful, deep discussions. And I don't know if you're aware of this. I mean, you go to conferences, but there's a little bit of angst that every speaker goes through when you go to a place you haven't been before and you wonder how you'll be received and whether your messages will be, you know, connect with the people there. But these folks were just amazing. And I hated to come home because I could have spent days there with them just talking and fellowshipping, and because it was just really, it was a special time. But then I got in the car, left around 4:22, not around. I looked at the watch. It was 4:22. I got home at 11:30 that night, and I drank 3 5-hour energy, whatever those little drinks you buy, you know, at the checkout counter at the gas station. And I drank some green tea, and I ate a whole bunch of fruit, and I was doing everything I could to keep myself awake because it rained almost the entire way home, and it was dark and dreary, but God helped me. And so I'm home, and I had Sunday to recoup, and here we are Monday morning. So what do you think of that?
That's a crazy weekend, man.
It was a crazy weekend, and I'm not younger. Yeah. And I wish I had someone to drive with me. In fact, that was my first thought when I was at the airport, was I thought, wonder if there's somebody that wants to go with me. I'd be glad to pay them so they can spell me and they can drive and I can rest and they can, you know, we can take turns. But I couldn't think of anybody that short notice. And so it turned out that the first part was pretty. It's a pretty drive up through central Pennsylvania. But then when it started to drizzle as I came into New York State, it was just kind of rough. But I did listen to 28 chapters of the Bible, so I got caught up in my Bible reading.
Caught up. Wow.
Well, I'm doing a different thing. I'm doing the racery, you know, that thing that's on our website, right? Where, oh, yeah. So, but I had only been doing, because I've been gone 3 weekends in a row, and I don't normally do that. And so I was already feeling a little bit, but I've only been reading 1 or 2 chapters a day when I'm at these conferences. And so I have been reading, you know, 7 or 8. A day. So I had to kind of push it a little bit. But it's fun listening to scripture. Okay, so there you go. That's an interesting podcast, but we do have a topic today which is appropriate. It's called A Day of Rest.
We need that.
I do. I could use a week of rest. Yeah. But according to scripture, I should work 6 days and just rest one. So let's jump in. Father, help us to understand this topic. These are eternal principles that you've outlined in your word. This is one of the Ten Commandments. They're not suggestions. But we live in a crazy world where we work all the time and we push ourselves. And I just gave a wonderful example of how I push myself. So now, balance us out and give us your thoughts on this topic. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
One tangible expression of God's blessing is the day of rest, which he has set apart for us. Quote, remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. 6 days you shall labor and do all your work, but on the seventh day is a Sabbath to the Lord your God. On it you shall not do any work, you or your son or your daughter, your male servant or your female servant, or your livestock, or the sojourner who is within your gates. For in 6 days the Lord made heaven and earth, the sea, and all that is in them, and rested on the seventh day. Therefore the Lord blessed the Sabbath day and made it holy. That's Exodus chapter 20, verses 8 to 11. There are two thoughts revealed in these scriptures which are extremely obvious and often overlooked. Work 6 days and rest 1 day. You do not need to be able to read the Bible in the original languages to understand this. Notice also that even though Moses was the first to codify this formula, it was God who popularized this approach. Genesis 2:2-3. On the seventh day, God finished his work that he had done, and he rested on the seventh day from all his work that he had done. So God blessed the seventh day and made it holy, because on it God rested from all his work that he had done in creation. Working 6 days is an exhortation to diligence, which we have discussed in a previous section. Resting for 1 day, as God did, is a prescription for sanity and a wonderful antidote to the culture of stress in which we live. God set the example. He worked for 6 days and then he rested 1 day. Can we improve upon this model? I think not. I have often seen the Sabbath as a list of what I cannot do. But this unique day is fraught with potential for what we can do. Isaiah 58, 13 and 14 reads, "If you turn back your foot from the Sabbath, from doing your pleasure on my holy day, and call the Sabbath a delight, and the holy day of the Lord honorable, if you honor it, not going your own ways or seeking your own pleasure or talking idly, then you shall take delight in the Lord. And I will make you ride on the heights of the earth. I will feed you with the heritage of Jacob your father, for the mouth of the Lord has spoken." Before we run down the path in our minds of determining which day to keep as our weekly Sabbath, here are a few thoughts for each of us to ponder from Romans 14. One person esteems one day as better than another, while another esteems all days alike. Each one should be fully convinced in his own mind. The one who observes the day observes it in honor of the Lord. I receive two insights from these verses. First, be fully persuaded in your own mind. Search the Scriptures. There are over 200 references to the Sabbath in Scripture, and it is an enlightening study. Seek God for wisdom on this issue. When you have arrived at a decision, apply the second insight, which is to give your brothers and sisters in the faith some space. If others don't agree with what you have discerned from your study of sacred writ, don't make this issue a bone of contention. Rather, keep these days unto the Lord. God designed us to work 6 days and rest one day each week. Emergencies and unique circumstances will arise. But if you make this a habit in your home and business, you will be working with the Creator. How you keep it is between you and God. But when you properly practice under Christ and in the rest which only He can provide, it will be a regular source of refreshment and a window of opportunity to spend time with God and your family. Hebrews 4:9. There remains a Sabbath rest for the people of God. Romans 7:6. Now we are released from the law, having died to that which held us captive, so that we serve in the new way of the Spirit and not in the old way of the written code. Galatians 5:1. For freedom, Christ has set us free. Stand firm, therefore, and do not submit again to a yoke of slavery. I have a tendency to look to the Word for wisdom and direction, which is right, but often forget to consider the heart of the loving, wise God who gave it to us. In directing us to rest, God, who created us in His image, knows what we need. We were designed to work for 6 days and rest one. Our lives will be blessed when we foster this divine rhythm. How grateful we should be to God for giving us this gift of rest. God knows us. He cares for us. All Scripture is inspired by God and flows to us out of His heart of love, for God is love. As the psalmist declares, "The Lord is righteous in all His ways and kind in all His works." Psalm 145, 17. Father, help us to set aside one day each week for our necessary rest. Thank you for the gift of rest and a day set apart to be refreshed. Inspire us to do so unto the Lord in newness of the spirit and not in oldness of the letter. Amen.
Amen.
There you go, Chief. What do you have?
I'm feeling like I need a day of rest. I confess I have, at times I've done well at keeping a day of rest, but I never feel like I totally make it all that restful. You know, even if I'm not working, I don't work on Sunday, you know, officially, but there seems to be, there's so much stuff to do. I don't know. It's just, I think we have, especially in our culture in America, there's such a tendency to make Sunday just sort of the do all the work you didn't do the rest of the week, you know, or do all the work around home, but I do my best.
Well, I think this is secondhand, but with another couple, we were ministering in Europe and talking to missionaries. We were there talking about education concerns and for missionaries and their kids, and there was a father's talk. So this friend of mine went over to the fathers and he was talking to them. And at one point he said, how many of you keep one day a week to rest? 1/3 of the men raised their hand. And then he said, how many of you are convicted about that? Same 1/3 raised their hand. Yeah. So not only were they not practicing it, they weren't even convicted about the practice. And I'm going to make another prediction. Those 2/3 of those guys who never rested are going to burn out. Mm-hmm. It's just, you cannot, you got to operate the equipment according to the guy who wrote the owner's manual. And he knows that we were not designed to work 7 days a week with nonstop. And of course, I understood their dilemma. These were missionaries in a really needy place. There was lots of work to be done. They had great hearts and they wanted to change their culture for Christ. And so it was very difficult for them to say no. And they would probably feel selfish if they were to say no and just go for walks in the park with their family or sleep in the morning and have a brunch instead of an early breakfast and read and be refreshed. But yet, you and I are sitting over here. Of course, we're the experts in America, but we know that that's probably the best thing they could have done because they would have been refreshed for their family and for their ministry. So I think about that myself because there is lots of stuff to do. And I've been maintaining for some time that the best thing I can do for my family sometime, last 5 years, is spend time with my dad because my vertical relationship determines how well I'm going to be horizontally with my wife and my kids and people that I interact with. And this is one more way that God has set apart. I mean, I could have spent more time on that, but that wonderful verse in Isaiah 58, if we will honor the Sabbath and take delight in the Lord, that he said he would help us to ride on the high places of the earth. I mean, this is not just a refresh your batteries kind of thing. This opens up more spiritual refreshment as well. So
much of what we do, I think, in the American church anyway, is I'm becoming convicted that a lot of it is really backwards or just slightly off track. And this is probably more of a different conversation maybe but I'll try and make it make sense. with this one, I mean, we don't care for our souls. You know, there's so little time that we spend in what I think is John Eldridge talked about soul care, you know, just taking time to truly rest. And whether that's, you know, Sunday or Saturday or whatever day of the week, or if it's an official day every week, like I think the principle is right and we should take a day every week. But at some point you've got to have time to care for your own soul and to spend time with God and get rest. I mean, and you look at Jesus, like he was always, you know, there were always more people he could have healed or more ministry he could have done. And yet there are numerous times where it says, and he went off by himself, you know, to be in a secluded place and get some rest.
Yeah. And you'd think he wouldn't need to be refreshed. I think you're right on target, brother. This is a good word. So, and he took his disciples when they came back and they were all pumped from their big first evangelistic trip, you know, where they came back and they're all excited. And he took them apart. He said, now rest a while.
I don't think there's anybody who could say they rest too much. You know, I mean, you know, I joke about being lazy a fair amount, but it's not true rest that I'm getting when I'm being lazy. It's usually vegging out in front of the TV, which is not caring for my soul, you know?
Yeah, my brother calls himself a lazy workaholic.
Yeah.
he has a unique way with words. And there are things that we can do that are more profitable than, like you say, watching a movie or just sitting in front, vegging in front of a television. And there are things that we can do that are more of a spiritual source of refreshment. And for me, one of my, and I've been missing it for the last 2 weeks because Sandy's been out of town and I can't leave Johnny in the house by himself. But last night I'm home, she's home. So I was able to go out for my evening walk with God and just spend time being in his presence and enjoying creation and listening to the birds and watching the sun go down. And that's a tonic to me that feeds me and refreshes me every time I go for one of these walks. Well, Father, help us to have the correct balance between being diligent and working in the Spirit and according to your principles, but help us also to know how to rest and when to rest and what's the best day to rest. And help us not only to find refreshment and soul care for our own bodies, souls, and spirits, but help us to lead our families well so that we can help them to also find the rest, which according to Scripture has been supplied to us. There remains a Sabbath rest for the people of God. Help us to taste and experience this Sabbath rest in this time of refreshment, not just for ourselves, but to reconnect with you in a deep and meaningful in a restful way. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. And that's our show for this week, folks. Thanks for joining us for the Building Faith Families podcast with Steve Demme. If you have a question for the show, email steve@spdemme@gmail.com. If you have a question for me, you can reach me at scott@unsocializedmedia.com. Thanks for joining us. Have a great week.